If you've been coding for a while, you probably heard of the solid principles. And if you're like me when I first heard of them, you probably thought they were some kind of construction techniques for digital skyscrapers. But no, they're just a way to write less terrible code. The solid principles are a set of design guidelines for writing code that makes it easier to manage, extend, and debug. They help us break big problems into smaller, easier to handle parts, reduce the dependencies on code so changes in one area won't break another, and reduce tight coupling, making code more flexible and easier to maintain. So let's break down these principles one by one and see how they can improve our code. Solid is an acronym, and here are our five main characters. S for single responsibility, O for open-closed, L for Liskov substitution, I for interface segregation, and D for dependency inversion. Sounds fancy, but don't worry, we'll go through each one with simple examples. To start off, imagine you're at a magic show. The magician calls you to pick a card, you pick one, memorize it, and put it back in the deck. Then somehow, the magician makes your card appear at the top of the deck. Your first reaction? What the heck just happened? But do you know what is the best way to measure the quality of our code? If you said what the hex per minute, you're right. So why did the magic trick surprise you? Because the magician was doing more than one thing at once. While he was distracting you with words and waving his hands, he was also sneakily rearranging the deck behind the scenes. That's great for magic, but terrible for code. We don't want our code to surprise us. That's exactly why the first principle exists, the single responsibility principle. As we've seen, this principle states that a class or function should have only one responsibility. Even more, it should have only one reason to change. But what does this actually mean? Let's look at this example to understand it better. Here we have a method that saves a user into the database and sends a confirmation email. Just by simply looking at this code, we can find at least 5 problems. If you change the database logic, like saving username instead of email, you might break the email part by accident. The database and email parts depend on each other, making updates risky. If another part of the code needs email sending, you'll have to copy the code. You cannot test the email and database separately, which makes debugging harder. And if you want to send an SMS, you have to change this method again. With this in mind, here's a better version. We've encapsulated the user data into a class, and we've split the code into 2 classes, the repository being responsible for database interactions and the email service for sending emails. Now the methods are clear, since they take a single user object rather than multiple parameters. Changes to one part of the code won't affect the others, each part can be tested separately, and you can easily add new features like SMS notification without touching the existing code. Now, did you ever have a phone update break something that was working just fine? One update and suddenly your flashlight stops working. Next update, your camera crashes. Every time they add something new, they break something old. A well-designed operating system lets developers add new functionalities without touching the existing ones. That's the idea behind the open-close principle. Software should be open for extension, but closed for modification. This means we should be able to add new functionality without touching existing code. Instead of modifying old code and risking breaking something, we extend it for inheritance or composition. How does this work? In this example, we have a class that processes different types of payment. The problem is that every time a new payment method is added, we have to modify this class, and changing existing code can break old functionality. So instead of modifying the payment processor every time we have a new payment method, we create a payment method interface. Then we create separate classes for each payment type. And finally, we change the payment processor to use abstraction, making it closed for modification. Now if you want to add a new payment method, no problem. We just create a new class that implements payment method. In this way, each method has its own class, keeping the code clean and reducing the need to change old code. But speaking of designing for flexibility, our next principle is Liskov Substitution Principle, for which we have this mathematical definition. But don't worry if you find that confusing. Let's simplify this principle with a simple example. Every phone uses a USB-C type charger. So if you buy a USB-C type charger, it should work with your phone, no matter if you have an iPhone or an Android. In this case, the USB-C type charger is our base type, and from here we have more subtypes. We have authorized iPhone charger, Samsung charger, and so on. But there are some third-party chargers as well, that are subtypes of the same USB-C charger. There were some cases of the third-party iPhone chargers that broke the phone by overheating it. It's clear that in those cases, the third-party charger didn't behave like a regular USB-C charger. And that's exactly what the Liskov substitution principle is about. Subtypes should behave like their parent types, without causing unexpected issues. If we have a bird class and a penguin subclass, and our bird class has a fly method, our penguin is going to have a bad time. But we can design our classes the right way. So we can define a general bird class, Then we create a separate class for flying birds. After that, we define specific bird types, and we make sure that our penguin is extending the bird type, not the flying bird. So every subclass can be replaced by its parent without breaking expectations, and the penguin class doesn't override the fly method that it shouldn't have. But have you ever opened a food delivery app and it started suggesting you to configure a loyalty program, enable notifications for special offers, and subscribe to the newsletter? But you just wanted a pizza. That's where interface segregation principle comes in. No class should be forced to implement things it doesn't need. A well-designed app would only show you the features you need without forcing you to deal with unnecessary subscription or notification. But for this time, I'm going to break this principle and remind you to hit the like and subscribe button. Back to our principles, we have this printer interface with methods for print, scan, and copy. This interface forces all printers to implement all these methods, even if some printers only perform printing, not scanning or copying. When you call scan or copy on a simple printer, it either fails or provides an unnecessary response. And if you need to add more printer types, you'll end up with a lot of useless methods implemented in those classes as well. So we can split the printer interface into smaller, role-specific interfaces, so that printers only implement the features they support. First we create small interfaces, then we implement role-specific classes. Now we have specific interfaces for different tasks. The simple printer class only implements print, and other useless methods are removed. And creating new types of printers become easier, without forcing unnecessary behavior in unrelated classes. But now we need to get back to our chargers, because we're traveling. When traveling abroad, sometimes the charger doesn't fit the power outlets, and we're stuck with a 1% battery, searching for an adapter. Here's the thing, the wall outlet doesn't care if you're charging a phone, a laptop, or a hairdryer, and your charger doesn't care if it's plugged into a wall, a power bank, or an airplane seat. They both rely on a common standard. Electricity. This is the essence of dependency inversion principle. Your code components should depend on abstract standards, like electricity, not specific implementations, like one type of outlet. But to simplify things, we have this example. We have a notification system, where a notification service depends on email and SMS service. Email and SMS service are concrete classes. So we have four issues. Notification service is a high-level module, but is directly dependent on low-level concrete implementation. If we need to add a new notification method, like push notification, we must modify notification service, violating open-closed principle 2. If email service or SMS service changes, we may have to modify notification service too. And unit testing notification service is difficult, because it is hard-coded to use both email service and SMS service. So instead of directly depending on concrete classes, we introduce a notification sender interface. Then we implement concrete notification senders, and we modify notification service to depend on abstraction. Now using notification service is flexible and extensible. If we need a push notification, we simply create a new concrete class that implements notification sender, and no changes to notification service are required. These principles are great. However, solid is not a strict set of rules. It's a guideline. Sometimes, breaking one of these principles may be necessary for performance reasons or simplicity. The key is knowing when and why you're making that trade-off, because with these benefits, solid comes with trade-offs as well. The benefits are clear. Our code becomes modular, making it easier to change and extend. It reduces bugs by keeping responsibilities separate and predictable. And it makes collaboration easier, as the code is structured in a logical way. But here are some trade-offs. It can introduce extra layers of abstraction that aren't always necessary. It may require more planning and a bit of a learning curve, and in some cases, these principles can make simple code more complex than it needs to be. The trick is balance. Use solid where it makes sense, but don't force it where it doesn't. You need to keep in mind that no system is perfect. And when things go wrong, because let's be real, bugs will happen, you need to be prepared for them. So watch this video next to see how efficient logging can reduce debugging time, and how to write logs that will tell you exactly what your code does when you're not looking.